Hey, how are you? It's time for our daily broadcast here from the Hub Culture Cabana in Times Square. Tonight, joining me is David Savage, who's a very interesting person that we met in January in Davos. And he's been here this afternoon working with us here at the Hub, focused on emotions and focused on feelings. And we're going to talk about that and what David's work is tonight. David, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
It's great to have you here. It's been a very interesting day.
I love it.
Yeah. Tell me a little bit about like the work that you do and how you do it.
So I'm an empath, and empaths, as you may know, are people who feel people's feelings. There are many of us. In fact, in some ways, we're all empaths. We all feel other people's feelings to some extent. What's unique about me is I'm able to tune into any given person at any given moment and feel their feelings. And I can do this both how they're feeling in the moment and how they're feeling on a deeper level. And their emotions move through my body physically, so my body expresses their feelings. So if somebody is sad, my body unconsciously turns in like this. Or if somebody is full of joy, I become like this. So I'm constantly reflecting back to people their feelings. And I do these readings. And today I was doing readings in this incredible space.
Cool. So tell me a little bit about how the day went. Like, how do people react when you say to a person, hey, I can feel your feelings, first of all, many people would find that a bit hokey or like unbelievable. Mm-hmm. How do you address that? How do you actually dive into a person? Can a person be resistant to it and you break through that? Or does a person have to be kind of open and accepting to what you're doing? Do you feel regardless?
Yeah, I feel regardless. So I don't mind if somebody thinks I'm full of it or if they're really resistant. If they walk in, they're like, okay, I'll sit with you, whatever, this is all silly to me. I will tune into them in this moment and I will reflect back to them what they're feeling. Sometimes people are really determined to not show any emotion so that I can't read them. But it really doesn't matter what they're showing or projecting. I'm not looking at them. I'm not cold reading them. I'm not thinking it out. I'm just feeling what they're feeling, so I reflect it back to them. And almost always, let's say 19 times out of 20, people go, yes. One time out of 20, people go, no. So I'm not 100% on the mark.
Right. And how did you develop the skill? Like, do you feel it's something you were born with? Are you learning it? Is it something that is expanding?
I would say it's a skill almost like music is a skill or musical talent, of which I have none. We all have some degree of musical talent. Some people have a lot of innate talent and they don't develop it and it just languishes. Some people have no talent, but they work really hard at it and they get okay. I think I happen to be uniquely gifted in the organ of my emotions. It's without my choice, it's a highly sensitive body, my emotional body. Over the last few years, I've been training it to reflect people's emotions back to them. And that's through a range of spiritual practices.
How did you discover it?
I discovered I was empathic when I was working through depression. What kept coming up as I was looking at my own depression was that I had been absorbing other people's feelings. And in order for me to get through my depression, in my unique case, I had to figure out how to release people's feelings.
From yourself?
From myself. Like, I was carrying
around. So you were like
around
a sponge.
Yeah. And I was all congested with other people's stuff. And I had to learn how to release those feelings. And when I did, I got to this place of hypersensitivity and openness. And then I was able to feel almost too much. I had to learn how to regulate that. And it was, finally, it was at Burning Man, where I was inspired to give my gifts of psychic readings at Burning Man. So I was doing this kind of on a lark. I was doing psychic readings. And during one of these readings, I took this guy's hand, and my body was totally taken over by his feelings. I didn't know what was happening, but I just started to describe what I was feeling. My eyes closed, and when I opened them, he was like, oh my God, that's everything that I've been going through. To do that. And since then I've been not really honing it that much, but just constantly doing it more and more and getting more and more good at it.
And do you feel like it's something that comes and goes? Do you have to be in a certain kind of mental state or physical state for you to be able to tap in? And is it easier for some people than others?
I machinery that makes me get into a flow. But that said, I can go into a zone just on a one-off. And there are people who are easier to read than others. There's also, there are some people who truly don't want to be seen, truly, deeply do not want to be seen inside. And those people I do not read. So if I sense that coming toward me, I will pass, or I will find a way around it. But if somebody actually on a deep level wants to be seen, even if they're saying, I don't know, or I'm shy, it's pretty much all the same. With the one asterisk that there are some people who are so disconnected from their feelings that no matter what I reflect back to them, they don't know what I'm talking about. They're just so in their heads. Their bodies can be doing one thing and their minds are off. These are almost invariably men who are just so disconnected that no matter what you say about what they're feeling, they don't know what you're talking about because they haven't had a feeling in 25 years.
How many people would you say that you've read or...
maybe 1,000.
That's
a guess.
So you've been doing it how long?
2 years.
2 years. Right. And how much of your time do you spend doing this?
Very little. Just whenever it shows up. More and more because it's interesting. But I certainly haven't been making a living at it. I've been exploring it. I've been following it where it wants to go. I've had a vision of turning it into a kind of performance art where I do it in a gallery. I'm working with a great producer who's been putting me in virtual space, virtual reality doing readings. I love that. I'm really excited to see where that wants to go.
How do you capture that in a virtual reality space if you're not physically with the person?
It doesn't matter. All I need is a voice or an image of a person. So in the virtual space, my avatar talks to their avatar, but it's our actual voices. And so I ask somebody, what did you have for lunch? And they say, chicken fingers. And I go into their feelings based on just two words. It doesn't really matter.
Wow. So is it like just establishing the connection?
Yeah. It's like a radio signal, and I tune into it.
Wow. And so, I mean, it's so fascinating. And I think some people who are intuitives and empaths, you know, they should know that we're looking at doing a week at the Hub Culture Innovation Campus in Bermuda this August, where we're inviting healers from around the world to join us for a week of just whatever happens, right?
Jamming.
Yeah, jamming.
One thing I've loved is, so my gift is in the healing body, the emotional body, and it's really awesome to work with people who work with the physical body or to work with people who work on the energetic level and combine forces. So like I'm tapped into somebody's sadness and somebody else is tapped into somebody's pelvis. But it turns out that those two things are actually linked.
And how much of that do you think is like an emerging school of thought or school of practice? Is it something that
I think I just came
really
up with
new?
It 5 minutes ago. Like I have never seen anyone even attempt to formalize jam sessions between healers, but it's an amazingly fruitful
Well, that's kind of what we're
energy.
Doing this summer, right?
Yeah.
So you have a week where people can just kind of convene and we're going to just see what happens. So I think it's going to be in the middle of August. So if you're into this stuff, or you feel like you have a gift in Reiki or intuitiveness or healing or channeling, can we talk a little bit about channeling for a
sure.
minute?
Sure, like, let's talk about channeling.
What do you, like, maybe we can even do channeling with me, because we've done that before in a foot zone. I don't know if I'm in the mental state or you're in the mental state, but talk to me about channeling and how would you describe what channeling is and what is the result of it?
Well, that word can be used in lots of different ways. We could say, right now, if I tap into your emotional energy, if I tap into you, I can become you on an emotional level. And I would say, like, right now, pretty open, calm, in your zone. I feel a little tinge of anxiety, a little bit of stress, maybe some feeling around other things going on that are not in this space right now that are gnawing at you, pretty low level. And that's where I feel you're at right now. Did I just channel you? Maybe. I'm channeling. The way the word is more typically used is people who are channeling spirits from other dimensions. And they can just open themselves up and suddenly other languages can even appear. This wisdom that wasn't there is for spirits. This is not one of my skill sets.
And do you think that those skill sets generally exist?
Yes. I think it's a difference of degree from what I'm doing.
Right. And so for what you're doing, how would you describe the channeling side of it? It's like, I know that you've been able to like essentially move physical energy in the sense that you can fill a person with energy or you can essentially draw energy? Is that how you would describe it? Or like on aside from the reading side, but just like almost on a Kundalini standpoint?
On the edges of my ability, I would say I'm I don't know about masterful of the emotional space in reading people, but I'm very advanced. On the edges of my ability, and here is a place where I'm really just a beginner, I sometimes feel into what's going on with people on an energetic level and can shift it inside their bodies or inside their beings. I'm even reluctant to say it because I'm so early on learning how to do this, and I only do it like if it feels really connected, and if somebody said, hey, can you do this for me? I don't know, I'm not sure. If somebody says, tell me what's going on with me emotionally, I'm like, let's get to work, I'm there.
Right. And that kind of energetic shift, like how would you describe that? I guess you probably, or if you run across people who can actually do that, who can do that shift, and how do you describe that shift from a physiological standpoint? Because is it only emotional, or is it actually something that is physical? It's physical, right?
Yeah, it's physical. I'm thinking of there was once this ball of trapped. I really wish I had a better word than energy, like a ball of tension in this girl's stomach. And when I went in there, I could just hold it with a kind of compassion, and I could feel it dissolve. Just merely bringing my own awareness to that ball of tension created the space for it to go away. I've had that experience sometimes doing readings. I have encountered people who are phenomenally gifted at doing just that.
How much of physical kind of pain and problems do you think is connected to the emotional and energetic side of someone's health?
The New Ager in me wants to say all. The Columbia University grad with an MBA who's a little bit more rational wants to say a fair amount. So somewhere between a fair amount and all. I frequently can see when somebody walks in the way their body is contorted because of their emotional life. So somebody literally who's like this is often closed-hearted, you know? Somebody who's literally like this all the time is often struggling from aggression they don't know what to do with. There's sometimes really quite literal relationships. It wouldn't surprise me if one day the science bears out that people who have heart attacks are suffering from broken hearts, stuff like that. Although I can feel the Facebook comments going, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about, to which I respond, yes, that is true. I have no idea what I'm talking about. None. I have no degree. I don't know anything. But I do know what people are feeling often. I do intuit a relationship between those feelings and their physical health.
Well, I think today, how many people did you intuit?
Maybe 10?
10. So I think I talked to many of those people coming out, and I think of all of those people, they said it was amazing. And there was one person who was upset because he felt like it wasn't on target.
Yeah.
So is that kind of like a pretty accurate, you know, 90% kind of hit rate in terms of people feeling like it's right?
That feels about that's my batting average. Yeah.
And that 10% is it? I mean, because you said something quite severe, and we won't go into it here. But, you know, from what you told me, you said something quite severe, that, you know, that's right. A big responsibility when you say something severe to somebody.
Totally.
And if it doesn't resonate, especially, you almost could be planting seeds, which could be negative. Over
yes.
Time. So how do you deal with that, and how do you bear that up? Because, you know, you're kind of playing with people's emotions to some extent.
Yes. I mean, I just want to validate the question. Like, I would even say, actually, somebody like the person I may not have just should not have named, who was dissatisfied, I would say that I'm doing the least amount of damage from that situation. He walks out going, whatever. If it turns out that there was a kernel of something true that I said, connect with, I think the real danger is actually people who are too open, who show up like, oh, David is sitting cross-legged and seems to be mature and wise. Whatever he says is true. Let me integrate it, even if it's not really true. Now, that's more my fear. He'll be fine, I think. He'll be like, what, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
The end.
Yeah.
So I guess I would say, like, it's like a doctor. You're gonna screw up if you never work, then you never help anybody. I'm showing up with my best intentions. Every morning I say to myself, I come from the heart. I do heart exercises to make sure that I'm in my heart. When I sit with someone, the first thing I say before I start reading them is that I'm here to serve them. In my mind, I'm conscious of where I may or may not be projecting. I am as aware of my own crap as I can be, or at least I try to see it. And when I start to say things that feel like I might be talking about myself, I pull back. If I'm edging around something that feels really vulnerable, I'll calm down. All of which is to say I'm doing my best and I'm not perfect.
Okay. Is there anything you want to do before we end this? Do you want to do something with me? Or do you feel like this is just about talking about this process, which I think is great? It sort of puts me in a vulnerable position in a way, but, you know, and we've actually, you know, to be fair to the group, like, we did this in Davos, so I've already kind of been through this experience, and I've felt that physically. Did people's experiences with it change over time? So that was 3 months ago. Would you have a very different, is it very much like a kind of core emotional reading that you do, or is it very much about how the person was feeling at that time?
Both. So I go through people in layers, both like what's happening in this moment, mm-hmm. which can change based on how you feel in 10 seconds.
And you kind of did that in a second a few minutes ago,
yeah.
where you said you're feeling generally calm, but
there's
things are not.
There's
right?
not anxiety.
Yeah.
We're getting at.
I'll just be quiet and we can say it and we'll give it a couple more minutes.
Let me just see if I can do something here of entertainment value and of self healing value, self development value at the same time. If I go into something that's going on with you beyond just this moment, there's something that's new that wasn't there last time we're in. And sadness. And it's sadness that feels very alive in you and in process with you. It's not repressed, it's not yelling to get out, it seems to be there. And there's nothing for you to do about it other than to continue to sit with it and be one with it as it comes forward. I don't think that was there in Davos, so I think whatever that is new and is happening to you.
Okay.
Or not.
Well, yeah, I mean, my father died Friday. Yeah. So I specifically didn't tell you, so I died. Yeah. So I had to leave here suddenly on Thursday night and fly down to South America, and we got to see him like 3 hours and then wow. passed on Friday. So, I'm very sad. And obviously that wasn't there in January. But in processing that, it's near the heart. But I don't know. At the same time, inevitable, because we kind of knew he was sick, but we didn't know he was very sick. And we certainly didn't think he was going to die. I haven't even told any of my friends or anything about it yet, because I just got back here to New York, and we jumped back into Times Square, and I had five of the craziest days of my life down in South America since over the weekend. Like, he died in my arms almost, and took my siblings, and his last words were to me, and then we had to deal with all the funeral and just everything. And so I got back, Friday, Monday, it's like,
wow.
I didn't know what day it was, Saturday. So I got back Thursday Thursday morning here, and then we've been here working. And the team knows, but we haven't announced anything. Nothing's been public yet.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. So, do you want to go deeper into that? What did you sense? Because that's.
Oh, I sense.
I mean, the fact that you would pick that up.
Real.
Yeah.
I mean, while still allowing this genuine sadness to be a part of you. You weren't pushing it down. I didn't feel this resistance to it, which is healthy. And your willingness to like sit here and share that is pretty amazing. So, and it's a model of like,
yeah, it's kind of,
you're being a beautiful leader by owning your sadness publicly. While still continuing to do what needs to be done.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just, it's not something we can really talk about, and I didn't expect that to come up at all, so, I don't know. But, I mean, I'm really sad. I've never been quite as sad as I have been last year my whole life. It's a weird kind of sadness. I mean, losing a parent is, it's funny on Facebook that this is happening, because a lot of my friends recently, I think we're getting to the age where our parents, some of our friends, their parents go. And I've seen these posts, and a number of my friends have lost parents in the last year or two, a couple of years. And it's this really emotional experience. And you can see your friends going through it or starting to go through it. And then you don't really think exactly about how it's going to affect you or that you're going to go through it. You know you will at some point. But it's really hard. And it's a weird sensation. I haven't lost a close family member before, and it's a hard thing. It sucks. It sucks for the parent because obviously they're gone, but it also sucks because you just, for me, for the first time I actually felt really alone. Like, and I was not even very close with my father, but he, somehow, that departure, I don't know, I think even if you don't have a close relationship with your parents, they're always, while they're alive, they're always kind of somehow psychologically there to protect you. Even if they don't physically do a good job of protecting you, somehow there's this psychological barrier of protection. And when that goes, and I felt like it was him going over a waterfall, and it's like, wow, you can see there's nothing between you and the waterfall. So. Thank you.
Thank you.
And you're doing incredible work, and it's great to have you here sharing that with us. So.
Thank you for inviting me to this incredible, amazing space in the middle of Times Square.
Yeah.
And for allowing, trusting me into your space.
Thank you. Transformation Station.
All
right. Well, that was one of our more surreal moments here at the Hub in Times Square. We're here for another 2 days. This is our last weekend, so if you haven't come to see us and you're in New York, please come see us tomorrow. Sunday, we're doing a lot of great stuff here. We have a sound healing from 6 to 9, and then we basically finish up, and this whole operation is going to move to the Innovation Campus in Bermuda, and David's week will be the middle of August.
Something like that. Yeah,
so stay tuned, and thanks for being here.